What else? Well, as I said earlier, there, aside from decisions that the government makes and other things and work we have to do driven by the applications that people bring to us and drive, then there's, we, from time to time, we look around and say, you know, here's an issue that people aren't really talking about or haven't, or maybe talked about not talking about enough or haven't really grasped the significance of it. So we generally pick one of these, two of these out each year and feature them. And we did two this year. When we did a story, we said, compost, nature's sense of humus. We always come up with some catchy titles if we can. And if you just try and draw the attention to compost, unfortunately, we, you know, compost, the first thing that comes is much of the discussion of compost has to do with the green box compost, which there have been problems with some of the composting facilities we've built. We're early in the technology and understanding this and managing this in the province, a whole bunch of stories around that. But the first and foremost is it's interesting that, you know, because that green comes from the steps, we think of compost as a waste issue. But, you know, really, compost is a waste if it's clean and done right and kept right. There may be problems with green bin stuff from time to time, depending on how it's collected, what's allowed in, and how it's handled. But compost, I mean, think of, I mean, up in North Bay, in my house, my wife and I, I'm not sure, we're the crazy neighbors, because, you know, we just went through this, all the people in the little suburban neighborhood, everybody rakes their leaves up and puts them in bags, right? And for the older people, my wife goes and collects all our leaves and brings them to our place, and for the people that are younger, rake their own leaves, we come, can we have your bags of leaves, you know? Nutty Millers are taking the leaves again, right? So the Nutty Millers fill their garage full of bags of leaves. And we have a mulcher, and we mulch it down to a finer thing, and we pour it on the beds. And two things my house and my wife is known for. She's the crazy lady who collects leaves in the fall, and everybody loves her garden. Because we have, I grow trees, she grows flowers and things. But we have rich, deep organic soil, because we mulch all these leaves, and you know, think about it. In the forest, leaves are this thick in the fall, about, in this, by next summer they're all gone, right? They've worked in, they create that rich forest soil. So there are organic residues that we have in our society that nature knows what to do with, and that is to make things grow and be in rich, healthy soil. It doesn't need much, any fertilization. It has, retains water much better, and it has huge, healthy, living ecosystems of nematodes and things like that, and creatures, arthropods, all sorts of, you know, worms, you know, and various things that are part of that biological ecosystem. So organic residues and linked to soil erosion, linked to healthy soil, with the reduction of use of pesticides or organic fertilizers. There is a huge opportunity for our society to deal with a whole lot of problems around land management if we recognize that organic residues, compost, properly composted organic residues, are a rich resource that help heal the land. The whole thing, there's some new data out on climate change and biodiversity. It's the International Year of Biodiversity. I have a person down in Nagoya, Japan right now at the international conference. Biodiversity is in trouble all around the world. You've probably heard that, but it's a very dramatic thing. It's written up in my report, if you get a chance to look at it. They projected, they're refining the climate change models. And one of the, I would say, a problem with the way we try to explain and talk about climate change that all the scientists have over the years is we often talk about 2100. We always say, you know, 2100 is the water level, so we're going to be up this way. Well, I mean, I'll sit there and say, like, who cares? I'm not there in 2100, you know, right? That's so far away as to be. That's 2100. But what they've done is they've broken it down for Ontario in 30-year projections. 30 years to 2100. And they show what they project the change in temperature, change in time zones will be through this. And if you look at, in Ontario we have a system of ecological regions. We classify landscape, we've used it for years, and just the ecological regions. And in those regions we get certain conditions, certain kinds of plants grow, and animals, etc. Like Southern Ontario is one of those regions that I write up in my report. And if you look at that ecological region of Southern Ontario, it's a, if you categorize it, you know, it's the beech maple forest that we see. It's like, you know, typically around here. We're not the hickories and things that get way down by Lake Erie. That's a different zone. This one is the sort of rich central Ontario forest. Well, conditions are what we naturally expect. That's driven by the large slice of that climate. If you look at how that climate zones change over the next 30 years after that, in fact, the climate conditions which give us this ecoregion shift right out of the region. In fact, they shift further north through the decades, so in just 90 years from now, 2100, the climate conditions that we experience here that support this kind of forest in Ontario will exist in Marathon, Ontario. Do you know where Marathon is? It's way up on Lake Superior, and it's a little map in my report that shows you where it is. And it shows the extreme change. Now, will we get, you know, sugar maple forests in Marathon? No, we won't. But they'll have our weather, okay? And that's the point. So the point is that it gets to Marathon in 90 years, but it starts shifting. It's shifting already. The climate is becoming warmer. The moisture patterns don't change a lot, by the way, for this part of the province. The projections are very, very modest to change in moisture, but big changes in temperature. And of course, that affects the drying effect. It does affect moisture not directly. But we're going to stress our plants and animals, our biodiversity, tremendously, not in the near term, in our lifetime. In my lifetime, if I live as long as my dad did, you know, that's one of these 30-year increments, and we will markedly change the climate regime through Ontario. It's worse for the north you go, by the extreme change for the north you go. But that poses a tremendous pressure on the natural biodiversity. And that's what we have to get our head around. We already stressed the biodiversity by invasive species, by our level of, you know, change on the landscape and disruption of things, sort of a sense of that. But we're talking about radical changes in climate zones in Ontario, which have tremendous pressure. We have to get our heads around it. It's not happening. It's profound by 2100, but in the next 30 years, which is many of us will still be around, hopefully all of us, in that 30 years there are profound changes coming in the climate, which will really stress biodiversity. So that's why we have to be very conscious of what we have now. So that's the stance of that developing issue. That's when you get a little sense the kind of thing that we can talk about. Now, interesting little thing though. You can't file that one because the Ministry of Education is not prescribed under the Environment Bill of Rights. It is not one of the 14 ministries. And the Ministry of Education's position up till recently, I think that, has been, because I have recommended several times that Ministry of Education, for a whole bunch of really important reasons, be a prescribed ministry and be subject to reviews. Their position is they make no decisions that are environmentally significant. Now, that's I've had a long-standing fight with Mr. and to their credit, I will acknowledge here today, they have told me they will become prescribed. Both the deputy and the minister have said they will. So going forward, they're going to be prescribed to some extent at least, and we'll see. Yeah, but so right now they exclude themselves, and the government's like, yeah, we have it. It's interesting because I, at one point previously I had both the minister and the deputy agreeing, but then they changed the minister and the deputy, and the bureaucrats were dragged, their feet didn't happen, and then the minister changed, and then I had to go back to square one.
They build infrastructure, they handle transportation.
Oh, yeah, it's ridiculous in the face. No, but the one that really set me off was when they canceled environmental sciences and tree teachable. And they alleged that wasn't an environmentally significant decision. Yeah.
To ask you about Bill 68, the Ontario Open for Business Act. Are you aware of that? Is your office been?
Yes, nothing's very clear on the ballot. One aspect of that,
Well, the fact that it takes away many of our rights under the Environmental Bill of Rights.
I'm not sure what that is. What are you talking about?
Well, I understand from Mark Matson from Lake Ontario Waterkeeper, as well as Eco Justice and Sierra Leone Defense, CLAP and CLAP, I think we're both. They've all made submissions because they're worried that this act is giving two streams for new approvals. So anything that needs a certificate of approval, 80% of those things can now be just automatically registered.
You're talking about the registration versus C of A, dual stream.
gets very technical, but here, I'll give it a quick run. There's always been a problem in province Ontario with the most significant approval process backing up. If you have a source of pollution and things, then you have to have a certificate of approval. I think it's been a rather elaborate process going through, it's been backed up in long delays problems. Now, there was the KFC factor. If you have a restaurant with a vent, you know, blasting out, that technically under the old legislation requires a full certificate of approval too. And generally speaking, the Inco Superstack and the thing that's blasting on the back of a little is probably quite a difference. So the way the ministry generally used to handle that is sort of ignore it, you know, even though legally it was required. So a whole lot of things were just ignored, but technically required. And every time there was an attempt to improve the approvals process and be more rigorous, everybody said, yeah, well, you want to bring in, 10,000 beds from the back of restaurants, everything, that'll dog us down for another 5 years, So it was a very practical thing. So what they've done is, they're talking about segregating them into two types. One's that it's approval by rule, and that is if you follow this set of rules on your events and do it in a certain way and have certain equipment, then you don't need to file any. You just have to tell us that you've done, you follow these procedures and installed this equipment, and that's good enough. You register that. And then the real things that have the kind of pollution control factories and various things that we sort of intuitively have a sense of, those go through the regular CMA process. So the issue is, because they haven't clarified how you split, right? So I don't think anybody has a problem with the small little vent behind the fast food outlet. We're going to handle that by permit by rule, and everybody knows how we're going to handle the emissions from an automotive plant, or a pulp paper plant. We're going to have the CFA. Where's the stop? What is the categorization? Haven't told us yet.
So do you have any influence? Can you act before they make?
Oh yeah, I was talking to them about that this week. I mean, we're in conversations with them, but they haven't said. I don't think they know. They're still trying to get a handle on where that is. But for these groups that are having problems, they're assuming the worst.
Well, it seems like it's going to leave it up to the judgment of the.
Oh no, there'll be a criteria, but it is a sensitive moment, if you like, right? Because that's the moment when lobbyists can switch things critically. So it is a sensitive moment, but know that there's a lot of people watching and talking. It could go south on us, that's true, I acknowledge, but it hasn't yet. Sir?
First, the
yes.
Security conditions, however, seems to me that it's really in the hands of the municipalities around the lake as to whether they follow the plan or not in their decisions. And I am concerned that so many of them are influenced by developers and the need to follow what the developers want to do, that plan isn't going to be.
I think you're right. I think if you read the section we did on, you'll see that written between the lines. My level of concern with the I characterize it the same way. This is a plan that can make big strides and big improvements and work quite well. It's not everything, but it's a difficult problem. However, it needs to be fully embraced in both spirit and letter, and proceed with. And we already know that there's some challenges with respect to bending the rules on development. But at least we've got a plan. At least has a framework that gives a framework which we can judge progress. But it's going to take persistence and diligence in pressuring municipal governments. I agree. I mean, the province. Hands are not clean with respect to respecting their own plan already. So, I agree. Let's go year by year. Start with good faith. Start with good faith. Reagan used to say, trust but verify. Similar sort of phenomenon, I think. Yeah.
I'm just curious, what size staff do you have to work with?
I now have a staff of 25. Under the Green Energy Green Economy Act, I got 6 more people. I had an army of 19, and now I have 25. Actually, I haven't played up with it. In the back.
Under the
behind you here.
Or you mentioned about the people could place complaints or compliance issues through your office, which would be funneled out to the appropriate ministry, you'll have 60 days to respond, and they could either...
Your person goes by, and another environmental group comes up with a different set of reasons why the Crucial Park Act should be looked at. It's in 1952, it's inadequate in this, it's in that, it's inconsistent here, and blah, blah, blah. Ministry of Natural Resources turns it down. And I slammed him again. And then, I'm sure it's next year, whatever, maybe a year or two later, another group comes, a different set of arguments, same thing happens. Okay, so I'm on record now slamming these guys three times. What's going on with this Crucial Park Act? I mean, every time the Ministry of Natural Resources said, we have reviewed, we've looked at your request for review, we see no need to, to review the Crucial Park Act. Well, 18 months goes by. The government says, we have an idea. We think we should review the Crucial Park Act. And so they did. And now we have the Crucial Parks and Conservation Areas Act. It's a damn good piece of legislation that says the first priority, First priority of our provincial parks and conservation reserves is protecting the ecological integrity of the land. And that's huge improvement. And where did the idea come from? Well, it came from the government.